So this is Blender, for sake of proofing everything. So if you were to hit new file, this is what you're probably going to get. I'm currently using Blender, this is 2.71? Anything that is relevant, if you're using from like 2.5 to 2.8, which comes out, I think, within the next couple months, this is going to apply. Blender hasn't really changed that much since the big 2.5 update of, I don't know, sophomore year for me, which is a long time ago. So the basics of Blender, Blender's a 3D modeling program. You kind of already realized this. If you didn't know about this, it's open source, which happens to go with it is free. It actually became open source back in the late 90s, I want to say. The company who was making the software went bankrupt. A bunch of people petitioned to let it go open source, and they actually bought the rights from the company as part of paying off the bankruptcy stuff, which is cool. So that's why we have this now. Blender Corporation runs it out of, I forget where, Northern Europe, I want to say Denmark or Sweden, somewhere in there. But really cool piece of software, very powerful, and especially it's pretty much the best thing out there that's free, which is great. So just as a suggestion, I'm going to go over some really simple things. You don't have to do this since no one here is using a laptop. You definitely don't have to do this, but just so you know, these are things that I've found that help out a lot. So if you're using the handy-dandy first-time guide, actually, Jill, if you don't mind, I'm going to put this back there with you, just in case anyone comes in.
Yeah, there we go.
And you can. This is just a handy-dandy shortcut guide.
I'm going to say it a little better.
Oh, you're good. Don't worry about it. I know you're a man of much demand. So if you're using Blender for the first time, there's a couple of things that you can do that'll help you out a lot. So, which I go over in this beginning, for everybody out there on the recording, this is a publicly available. Just find me at BlueHatZach on the social media and I can get this to you. But you would go to File and then User Preferences, and there's a couple of extra things that you can set up which helps you a lot. This goes to Input. And then right here, I wonder if I have something, but right here at Emulate three-button mouse, that allows you, if you're on a laptop which only has a right and left click and you don't have a middle mouse button to do rotations, that allows you to use Alt and left click, which is great because then you can have those same functionalities and shortcuts but on a laptop. As well, Emulate numpad, normally on your number pad, if you think of it, you have, you know, your tic-tac-toe style. And so, you know, if you want to go down or up, you can go in that direction. But, you know, when you think about it, it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, writing upside down, whatever, and backwards hard. Anyways, so you have all the numbers in order. And if you don't have that on a laptop like mine or most people's, you lose out on that feature. Emulate numpad allows you to still hit 1 or 3 or whatever, hit that thing, and it'll snap to that location for you, even if you don't have the numpad, just using your basic number keys at the top of the keyboard. So that's very, very, very helpful if you're on a laptop. Even if you're not, you get used to it, like I do, it's great to have on your desktop as well. Those are two important things, and then once you do that, you can click the Save User Settings, and that'll apply for the rest of life. And then the other important thing, which I'll get to more so in a second, but is this little button, just so you kind of see it, is this little guy right here. It allows X-ray view. Very helpful, but we'll get there in a second. Anyways, cool. We're still good. Alrighty. So, as some people had mentioned earlier, often you just open Blender and you look at it and you're intimidated and you just close it. It's a very natural reaction, but it is okay. So, the core basics of Blender, really, is how do you interact with this? Actually, yeah, can y'all see that grid space? I was going to make it a little lighter. Is that still good?
I can barely see.
Okay, I'll make it a little lighter just so that way it's a little easier to visualize.
I don't think you're going to get it on the camera.
It's okay. You can actually turn it up real high.
The camera's not picking up right. Oh, gosh.
Yeah, like I said, you can turn it up pretty high.
The camera's not getting a very clear image
of that itself?
Yeah, the projector, because it's the projector.
Oh, okay. Well, I can't do anything about that.
Yeah.
But y'all can see that, which is great. Cool. So the basics, when you start to look at Blender, you've got your mouse, and then you've got selections. So with selections, basically the easiest way to remember it is the ABCs of selecting, because those are your shortcut keys. A, B, and C. It's really simple in that regards. If you hit A to select, it hits all. Ooh, actually, let me turn on another feature just so y'all can see this. Boom. Blender has a nice little add-on where you can turn on screencast keys, so you can see when I hit something in the corner, you can see what I hit, how many times I hit it, it's great. You have to enable that feature in hidden menus, but it's there, it's great. So if you hit A, you select everything. If you hit A again, you deselect everything. This is great. It's very wonderful if you're trying to find that one thing, or you know, you've got something selected, you're like, I have so much other stuff, I don't know what's going on. Just hit A a couple times, and then you'll know that it's gone. For B, you've got box select, so if you hit B, you have this nice little thing, just like if you're messing around on your desktop, click and drag, and then I think after that, it is not selected. Everyone tracking so far? Cool. And then C is circle select. Also, fairly self-explanatory, but if you click and hover over stuff, you're going to select it, which is very, very useful. All the different selections are great for whatever you want to use. Now, the mouse also can confuse people sometimes in Blender, because you actually right-click to select things, and you left-click to move the cursor, which most people like left-clicking for things. It's backwards. I'm sorry. You can technically change it. I don't suggest it, but that's just how it is. Handy-dandy sheet, and get used to it, because it's actually, it's fairly intuitive once you get used to it. It's just, sometimes you just have to know in the beginning that that's how it is. But if I was to select something, I can right-click. You can see the little thing. Just right-clicking to select it, just like the slide over here. Right-click to select. A standard Windows shortcut is if you're holding Shift and selecting things, Shift and left select, Shift and right select, you'll select multiple things. So I can select all these different things and deselect them as well, just by holding down Shift and then selecting. Yes?
How do you deal with panning if you don't have scroll bar? Scroll.
Okay, so cool thing about that, which is, it's actually right here, just for your reference, it's right here on the sheet. But what you actually can do is use that emulate three button mouse that we set up earlier, and that allows you, so instead of your middle mouse, it's now alt left click. So this is kind of leading straight into what I'm saying. So that selection, so now you start getting the camera movement. If I was to want to just kind of like rotate around the screen, let me see which one is it. There we go. So this is alt and left click, which is showing up actually on there as the middle mouse button. But alt left click allows you to rotate around the screen in an orbit style. If you want to pan, let's see which one is it. Shift alt left key, left mouse button. And then if you wanted to zoom, it's control alt left mouse button, and that allows you to zoom. So you still get all the same functionality, even if you just want to scroll in and out, because I don't actually have a scroll on here, so that's how I have to do it. But it's all the functionality is still there. You just got to know your shortcut keys. So in terms of navigating the screen, that's the basic way when you start using the mouse, middle mouse button as well as alt left key. That's how you're getting around your scene. And if you want to start snapping the scenes, because if you've ever tried 3D modeling something before, modeling in this format is just an awful idea. So a lot of times, especially if you see people who are used to, I think it's Maya might be the standard for it, the screen is divided into quadrants, so you've got a front, a side, a top, and then like a perspective view. And you can set that up in Blender if you really like doing that. The default isn't like that, but it's okay. The way Blender accomplishes it, if you remember the nice little emulate number pad, if you hit 1, you're gonna snap to the front, 3 is the side, and 7 is the top. And if you notice, we're still actually in perspective mode. Everything, you know, looks nice and like normal 3D-like. You know, that looks like a realistic cube for the most part. If you hit 5, you go into what's known as orthographic mode, which basically is points farther away from you do not get smaller. So it just takes out perspective. What that means is if I'm in front view, now this looks like a perfect square, which is, because it is, it's in a 2D shape. We took out the depth perception of the 3D part. So you hit 1, 3 for the side, and 7 for the top. everything's there, and now we can actually work with this model with and actually model with precision. So usually you're going to be modeling in orthographic view, and then you're actually checking your work in perspective. So that's the 5 toggle, which on your mouse, on your emulate numpad, is right in the middle. If you don't have a numpad, learn. I'm sorry. There's not a lot of times in Blender. There's not an easy suggestion for some of these shortcut keys. USB numpad, external keyboard, something. But it becomes more natural with practice. So that's really the only solution is to practice. But is everyone tracking so far with kind of how to navigate? Cool, because a lot of times you try to select something and you just can't, and then you get frustrated and move. So that doesn't really help anything. All right, so basic other tenet of Blender. So you've got object mode and edit mode. There's other modes. There are several other modes select something and look here. You can see there are other modes here, but for the most part, until you start using some other weird stuff, you're really just going to toggle between object mode and edit mode. And the basic idea of that is edit mode is where you can actually manipulate the individual vertices of the shape, and object mode, you're just moving the entire object around the scene. There was a good example for that. We'll just move on. So if I wanted to delete this here, and come back, you can see, so the mesh itself is functionally changed, but the object never moved. It still has the same data there. It's all collided around that. So another point to bring up about this, sorry, there's a lot of things you have to learn in the beginning. I apologize. If I go too fast, slow me down. But one thing about Blender as well is you've got your origin point. So this is where Blender thinks everything is floating around. If you're looking at it from the sides, by default, everything's usually right in the middle of your object. It's either in the middle or typically at the bottom. So like, let's say you had a vase that you want to sit on top of a table. You're going to put it in the bottom, not necessarily at the center of gravity or where everything's going to orbit around. You want to put it at the bottom, so that way it's your perfectly flat coordinate point. Wherever you put it in your game or something is going to map perfectly to the table. You don't have to do some weird like offset by 0.6. It's going to be very nice. So you can actually move the origin down. I'm getting a little ahead of myself, but if you're curious, you just move your mesh and leave the origin where it was. That's kind of how you get around that. Yeah, so we're going to look into edit mode now because that's actually where you start to do some stuff. Objects is just really just throwing basic shapes around the room. Edit mode's where you get something that's actually fun to work with. So let's see here. So we're going to kind of get something that looks a little bit more like a standard Blender start. And we're going to go ahead. So once you start adding objects, you can hit Shift A. It's going to bring up this little add menu so you can see going to work with a cube. I love cubes. Cubes are great. People have a love-hate relationship with the default cube, but I am a great fan. And if you notice, the cube appeared way over there. We want it in the center. Why would it appear there? Because there's this other little thing that Blender does. A lot of little things. You can see this little cursor. It kind of looks like a crosshairs. That's in the screen, you have a cursor. It's right here. It's got an x-coordinate and a y-coordinate. In Blender, you have a 3D cursor, so it has both a X, Y, and a Z coordinate. So wherever your cursor is by default is where you're going to create your object. And there's a nice handy-dandy little shortcut to put this back to 000, and that's Shift-C, and you can see now cursor is right back where we want it. So now when we go, we can delete this real quick, and if we were to hit Shift-A, and go up to a mesh and add a cube, it's going to be right there in the center, right where we want it. Shift-C is going to be one of your favorite shortcut keys because that little cursor is going to move whenever you hit left-click. And if you're used to left-clicking a lot instead of right-clicking, that's going to move a whole lot. So Shift-C makes everybody happy. Alrighty, so let's go ahead and actually look at the objects themselves. So for some basics, let me go ahead and pull this up again real quick because I've got hidden. We're going to start with something very simple, picnic table. Picnic tables are happy. This is stressful for everyone. Blender is stressful. We go with something happy. It's very simple. So the nice thing about this, when you look at it, which is why I like picking it as a simple model for describing stuff, is that everything here is cubes, if you think about it. All of these are just planks of wood, which are just oddly shaped cubes, which we can move and stretch and manipulate to actually look something like this. So this is kind of going to be our reference image, but we're going to go ahead and make something like that. Shouldn't be too hard. Everyone think we could do this?
Yeah.
Cool. All right. Everyone think they could do this without me here? Hey, I have some hope. All right.
I've messed with Blender. It takes a lot longer.
Yeah, it takes a lot sometimes. Be patient with it, because sometimes you can get good at it and then blow people's minds, and it's great. But it does take the work, sadly. But so does everything else. All right, so for starters, let's go ahead and just make a table, like a table surface. So this is going to get into actually how to manipulate these things. So in Blender, you've got three basic controls. You've got grabbing something or moving it, scaling it, and rotating it. I prefer grab over move because the shortcut key is G, not M. So if you want to remember it, just use the nice little things that it has. So so if I wanted to actually like move this whole thing, I can hit G, and now it's going to move wherever I want. I can hit right-click to take that command out of the section and go back to wherever it was, or I can hit left-click, and it's going to submit it to wherever that was. If you want to be precise, which this is pieces of wood, we can be fairly precise with this. We don't just want to eyeball it. If you want to be precise, you can use control. So control is actually going to allow us to snap. So let's see, if I'm moving this around, if I'm hitting control, you can see it snapping to those grid spaces, which is wonderful. We can be very precise with this. If we want to be a little bit more precise, you can actually hit control and shift. It's actually going to snap to the tenths of that. So control snaps to ones, and this moves, shift snaps to an extra decimal point. So it's tenths of that. And if you were to zoom in farther, it's going to be similar. So that's grabbing with control and then grabbing with shift and control. And you can see it's moving much slower. But it's still, you probably can't really see in the corner, but it's actually snapping by hundredths of a space. So your snapping and moving is actually relative to this camera size you've got. What's up, Paul?
I know you said it's related to camera size, but can you adjust these amount of snaps to manually?
You can, I think. That would be a great question for Google, but you're probably going to find it. It's something I've never had to look for.
Okay.
You're probably going to find it in File and User Preferences, and it'll have a snap feature for it. I know I've seen that around. I'm not sure where it is. But you can set it where, like, your Blender default, instead of for you, you might just want it to snap by halves. So I'm pretty sure you can set that up within Blender itself. And that would just be something unique to your user settings. Any other questions as we keep going? Cool. So that's your grab. If you want to scale something, no questions. If you want to scale something, and you hit S, it all works. And guess what? If you hit Control, it still snaps. And control shift also still snaps, much smaller so you can't really see it. But all these commands, they basically have a kind of like an architecture where it's you input this type of command and then these modifications all work off of the same basic commands, which is great. So let's say I wanted to rotate and I didn't want something really weird. I want like an exactly 45 degree angle on this. Boom, you can see, you might be able to see in the corner. Right there in the bottom corner beneath the word cube says rotate 45, and that's because I'm holding down control. As soon as you take it off, it's going to be very hard for me to get that. But the control snaps just like it would if it was on the scale or if it was on the grab. All of the commands still work with those same core modifiers. The shift for minute changes and control for snapping. You can also do shift without control, and you get really minute freehand movement, which can be useful, not always, but it's definitely there. So the controls, everything kind of stacks, which is great. All right, so we are building a table. Cool. So let's go ahead and make a tabletop. So, easiest way to do this would probably be to just take this piece of wood we've got, if you imagine this piece of wood, and just smoosh it down really, really flat. As with any technical problem, there's multiple ways to do this. So for starters, we're just going to do a somewhat elementary way of doing it, and we're going to select the top part up here, and then move it down, and then select the bottom and move it up. So that way we kind of smush it together. You can also do this with scaling. We'll do it with scaling later, but just so you can kind of see different ways to approach this. So now we're kind of going to build on all the tenets I've just described in the past, I don't know, 20 minutes. So if I hit B for box select, so I can now highlight and grab all this stuff. If I was to kind of like move around, you can see, yep, I do in fact have all of that grabbed. I'll go over that in a second. So we're going to take this and we're going to hit G, and that's going to allow us to grab this. We can hit Control, and it's going to let us snap it down. And let's say, you know, we're having some real trouble getting it go down exactly right, and like, it's just not quite getting it. I'm just not quite getting it there. If you're paying attention, you actually have your axes. So in Blender, it actually says what axis you're looking at. So red is X, and blue is Z, green is Y. You can see it's here, the widget in the corner reminds you of that. And just the same way you can hit Control to snap it, you can hit Z. And now it's going to snap all of this to the Z axis. So no matter where my mouse moves laterally, the rest of it doesn't move laterally. So if I'm doing this, mouse, it moves everywhere the mouse is mapped to. If I snap it to the Z, it's only snapped to that Z axis, which is great. Allows for this for a lot of precision. Then we can also hit Control, and now we're snapping very precisely to where we want it. So I'm going to do the same thing. Hit A to deselect, because, you know, if I'm not sure what all is selected, just button mash until it's good. Gonna hit that. Gonna grab in the Z, hold Control to snap it, and now we have a somewhat nice flat little piece of thing. Actually, what a there we go. What's gonna there we go. What orientation am I in? Sometimes the shortcut keys didn't be too much room. Okay, there we go. Alright, sweet. That's where I was. Cool. So now let's go ahead and give this some width. What's standard table? 4x6, 4x8? I think 4x8 is like removable tables. I think 4x6 is a little bit more standard for like a picnic table. So let's go ahead and try that. So if you are curious and you really care, Blender units are technically, each unit is a meter. You can set it up to be feet if you want to, but by default, each unit is a meter. They're just Blender units. But if you were to make a, like, looking at Blender versus Unity, if you were to make a Unity cube, a default Unity cube, it's 1 meter squared. If you were to make a Blender cube, it's actually 2 meters squared. Cubed, sorry. So they actually are functionally different sizes. Yes?
I'm able to follow, but you didn't explain the whole size, rotate, and different editing types.
Good point. I'll probably do that more as we keep going, because it's a little easier.
You had it on resize.
Yeah, it's a little easier to kind of do that, like explain it as you're going, because it's kind of hard. But yeah, as I do this, I'm gonna make each piece with a different command, so you can kind of see all of them in action. But thank you for reminding me; I do appreciate that. So now that you said that, we're actually gonna scale this instead of just moving the points. We could grab these points and. Let's say if you were to take this and, you know, you could grab these points and move them out, or we could just take the whole thing and scale it. So if we hit X, we can scale that whole thing. That's not. I'm gonna change the view here. There we go. So we can kind of see a little bit better what this is doing. So if we hit scale, you can see it's actually scaling the whole thing. We can constrain the axes. We don't need to be like this. So if I just want to make it, let's say we're gonna make it a 4 units on the X and 6 units on the Y, which is that green one going back. So I want to take this and hit scale, and we're going to scale it, constrain it specifically to the X. So now everything works great, and it's only on that axis. So I'm going to hit Control and just hold it down until I see that nice little thing in the corner. Oh, that's actually way too big. We're just going to do 4 Blender units, which is a 2.0 scale. So yeah, so now if we look at that, that is 4 units across, which is great. That's how glad our plan was. Looks splendid. And I'm actually gonna do something real quick because I accidentally messed something up. I think that's right better. Yeah, that looks better. Okay, cool. normals flip if you don't care. So we're going to take this and let's scale it again in the y-axis for 6 units. And you can see I'm snapping around a lot with our views, just so I can see which one I'm looking at. This is a top-down view, so we can kind of see a little bit better. It's a little easier to work with. A lot of that just takes practice and familiarity. But if I'm going to scale it in the y-axis, I'm going to hold that down until, boom, that is a 4-box by 6-box tabletop. Cool. So we have that. Now we can actually grab it and move it upwards. And there's different ways you can do it. I'm trying to show you different ways that you can accomplish the same problems. I could hit G and hit Z and then snap it. It'll snap directly to my mouse and then allow me to take this whole thing up. Or this nice little thing here in the middle is called the widget. Widgets allow you to do different things. So in this case, this is a movement widget. So if I was to grab this and, whoops, hang on, where is it? Come here. Is it left click? Yeah, there we go. So if I was to left click on this Z arrow, it's just going to move it specifically to that. So it's the same thing as hitting grab and then constrain to Z axis, but it's a little bit more convenient because it's right at your mouse tips. I advise learning both. Don't constrain yourself to one or the other necessarily. All of them have their uses. And if you're someone who likes modeling in different softwares and you're really curious, widgets often have a scale version and a rotate version, just like all these other commands. So these little widgets down here allow you to do scale and rotate commands in the same way. So that's all located right down here. Cool. So let's not do that. We're going to put my widget back to normal. So we're going to grab this thing and what's that, about 3 feet off the ground? Looks good to me. Cool. So now we have a table magically floating in the air. It's great. So let's go ahead. What would be necessary for next? Probably some legs. Legs are good. We like legs. Let's go ahead and make some legs. Okay, so an easy way to do this for me would probably just be start with a new cube and then manipulate it from there. So from here, we can actually still hit Shift A and add a cube. So there we go. There's our nice little cube. And we can scale this down, S and then Y. So I'm scaling it in the axis. So now we kind of have it much thinner, so it'll be correct on that edge when we start to move it over there. You can hit G to move it up, so now everything is flush with the ground. It's a little hard to see that red, but when you rotate it, you can see. Just moving these to be flush with the ground. It's one unit up, so just holding control allows you to snap exactly to the ground. Keeping everything flush with the ground is great. Yes?
Is symmetry or mirroring harder on the computer? Like, if you want to do both ways at the same time?
That's more than what I was going to look at, but actually I can still show you how I would do that. It's actually really easy. It's great.
Is it tougher on the computer?
On here?
No, I mean, like, tougher on the resources.
Oh, on the resources? Not at this level, for sure not. Basically, what Blender does is it's actually called modifiers. So you're actually adding something on top of the mesh that's already there. And pretty much the modifier creates the mesh without actually creating the editable points. So then you can see it. It's the mirror is over here. And I'm working over here, but I see the mirror on the other side. And it allows you to see everything that's happening, but it doesn't ever apply it. Once you hit apply, then it actually creates those points as editable. But up until that point, it's pretty much all the same data. And I will show you what I'm talking about, just because you asked. And as an artist, you actually care a lot about mirror modifiers. It's a little bit more advanced, but it's definitely something that I enjoy talking about, because this is where the cool stuff is. Like, let's be real. So just for sake of this, also, if anyone cares, Blender has layers. So I'm going to invoke that real quick, just so we can do that. You can hit M to move to a different layer. Boom, so now we're looking at a different layer. So now the other stuff's on the other layer, we just don't see it right now. You can hide it, and hey, layers, cool. Sorry, yes.
Where did you
layers.
When you hit it?
Right here is actually where the layer selection is. So you probably can't see it, but there's a little bitty dot. So everywhere there's a dot is where you have mesh data. So it would mean that there's actually an object on that layer. And if you hit M, it pulls up this move to layer thing. Yeah, I was hoping to have a whiteboard where I could like write out all my shortcuts that aren't on there. Please write them if you have, if you need a pencil, I can definitely give you a pencil. I brought a couple extras, I hope. Anybody else need a pencil there? Cool, all right. Yeah, this move to layer is great if you work with layers. I only work with them when I have a ton of stuff in the scene or if I want to do an example like this. So if I was to work on modifiers, over here is this great panel, which we usually talk about at the end, which is where a lot of the fun stuff happens. Right up here where the wrench is the modifiers. So if I was to go here and add a modifier, you can see I have tons of really cool toys to mess with. This is when you get some power right here. So right here would be our mirror modifier. So we're going to go ahead and turn this on. And nothing changed. That's because everything's perfectly mirrored at the moment anyways. We're right at 0, 0, 0. Mirroring is just the exact same thing what it already is. If you see us moving it, now we have that mirrored function right there. So, and everything, things aren't actually mirrored on the Y, like the XYZ axis. It's not mirrored here, it's actually mirrored relative to the origin point. So if I was to take this whole thing and shift it sideways, it's all still there. And if I'm to, you know, if I'm gonna grab it again, everything's mirroring based off of that origin, not the global origin. So keep that in mind when you're doing modifiers like this. Also, you can see we have nice little selection boxes over here. I don't want to mirror it on that axis, or maybe I want to mirror it on all the axes. You know, we can do that too. And then we grab it and start doing some really cool stuff. This is when you start getting the powerful. But if you notice, right now, we're in edit mode, which means we can edit all of these vertices. But all of these other vertices, we can't edit right now. That's because we haven't hit apply on this. If I wanted this, if I'm like, this is what I want to work with, I want to make every single one of these cubes different, I can then go from here. Maybe I don't want to. Maybe I want them to look all the same. So you can actually do that. So if I were to take this right here and move it, every single one of them respond because they're all the same object going through this modifier. So also, like, you can actually turn it off, like, visually. If I was to turn it off, you can see. This is the only thing we're editing. There's only one. But modifiers allow us to do a lot more stuff with that. Super cool tools, super fun stuff. I can hope if I have a little bit of time, I'll show you some other stuff at the end. But that's, yeah, that's definitely a cool one, one of my favorites. All right, so delete that, go back to here. Cool. The reason why I don't do mod like that here, other than a little bit more advanced, is if I wanted to do a mirror modifier in this case, it would be great because, you know, I'm going to go here and move these legs out, and it's going to allow us to do, you know, two legs at the same time. But it's actually also mirroring this top object because this is all one mesh data. So now there's 2 points here, 2 points here, 2 points here. It's on top of itself. So if I was going to do this with a mirror modifier the correct way, if I want to make it really easy on myself, I would build this object first, build this as a second object with a mirror modifier, create the legs, join the two objects together, and then now I can make it as one mesh, like apply the mirror modifier and then make join it as one mesh. So that way everything's applied, and then Blender treats it as one object. It doesn't really change anything from there. But for sake of now, we're not gonna do that. Also, because this lets me show you rotation, which I like. So we're gonna scale this in a little bit just for artistic purposes. Take this and match it to the top of our table right here. And that looks good. And select that whole thing. So now what we can do is we're gonna take this, duplicate is Shift D. I don't know if that one's on my guide. No, it's not. Shift D is not, I don't believe, is the same thing as copy, just as a FYI. So we're gonna move it over, and then from here we can hit rotate. And you could rotate in free space, but that's not gonna really turn out so well for you. If you notice that, it's totally, it's you're, when you rotate not in a fixed view like this, it rotates freeform. So you might say, oh, you know, that looks kinda close. It's not even gonna be close. Go ahead and constrain yourself to an axis or constrain yourself to a viewport, so that way you're rotating specifically. But so you can see it, and did you have a question? Okay, just so you can see it in action, like in a more 3D view, if I was to hit rotate and then constrain it to the Z axis, so you can see I'm actually gonna spin it like a little carousel horse on the top. From here, I can, oops, sorry, too much stuff happened. Rotate on the Z axis, you can see it spins perfectly. I'm gonna match it up to 180, that's a 180, sweet. So now we have two things that look perfect. Gonna take this, move it over, and if we had a mirror modifier on all this, it'd be great, but we don't, but that's okay. So we've got that point, and if we wanna make it, again, make it for ourselves super easy, we can hit Shift D and duplicate it. And again, we can't move this freeform. If I was doing this by myself, I'm just gonna hit Shift D and drag it over. There we go, and drag it over. That's really what the right way to do it. You can get much more precise with that. Let's go ahead and make something else a little bit. We're ending at 415, I think. Someone double check on that, 415? Okay, cool, so I guess I've still got some time. So let's go ahead and we can just do some essentials. Let's drop in this guy right here, and then this box, and maybe that middle one if we can. I'll just kind of get through this so we can look at some of the more cool stuff in Blender. All right, so we're gonna scale this and the Z down. We make the seats right here. So grab that, scale it in the X. That looks kind of good there. Scale it in the Y, 6 feet, just like the rest of the table. Boom, that looks pretty cool. Duplicate that. That's right about right. Again, no mirror modifier, we're not being exact, kind of eyeballing it. But if you're control snapping and eyeballing it, usually you can get pretty accurate without much effort, as noted. Let's go ahead and add the things the bitches magically sit on. We're gonna move that over here. Sometimes it takes just practice, remembering which one you're looking at, and patience with yourself. Let's take that, move it up here. I'm actually, instead of scaling this one, just to make it a little easier on myself, I'm just gonna grab these points and move them up. And then this actually scaled with an X. So that looks fairly good. Grab this, move it in, give us some nice little angles to work with. Grab that, also move it in. Great handy dandy shortcut key, especially this one took me years to find out. Be thankful. I'm telling you now. If you have any point selected on any continuous mesh object and hit Control L, it will change your life. Instead of me having to go back and select every single one of those little points, it selects the whole mesh part for me. It's wonderful. Now, if I was to, like, it won't select all this other stuff because they're not connected. If I was to, like, maybe make a face here, to make a face here and then select one of them, it'll select all of it. So it has to be a connected mesh. But when you do that, it's really nice. So you're like, oh, that's the one point I want. Yep, cool, Control L. Got it. Don't have to do the tedious part of making sure you get the right points and not all the other points. It's wonderful. So Control L, grab that, snap it. It's starting to look pretty good. Just for fun, make it look pretty. We can, let's go ahead and add that last little angle piece for supports. Right here on the side, so that way our table won't collapse on itself, even though, you know, it's not great as is physics-wise. You know, clearly it is a piece of wonderful artwork already. So looks good. Grab that, move it over. You see a lot of Blender's just practice and repetitive tasks. You know, it's nothing. It is daunting in terms of the interface. But I can tell you that there are artists in here who are much better than I am, and I can do this. So I know for sure that y'all can. Did y'all see what I just did there? Just manipulating vertices. Okay. Y'all, I'm seeing confused looks.
What's the press for that?
So right here. So basically right here, I'm just working with a little cube. So I'm going to zoom in real quick so we can kind of see it a little easier. The Z is a wireframe mode, so that way we're not always working with solids. You can see it in the wireframe. Right here, all I'm actually going to do, instead of having a cube with sides that are parallel, I'm just going to extend this up and then take this side and flip it down. That's all I did. It was nothing really fancy.
You just like a point in there and stretched
it? Yeah, I just grabbed it, moved it over. So there's two different ways you could do this. You could put it here, so I know that this bottom point here is exactly my center, and that's where I want it, so then I could take that upper vertice and move it right here, and then it'll look good. Or I could actually take the whole line and put it, I could take this whole selection line, put it kind of in the middle, and then rotate it. So then, and make it flat again. And now we have something that we can work with. The other one's a little bit more accurate in this specific case, but both are very useful to be able to do that. Then I'm just gonna take that whole thing, duplicate it, move it over somewhere real close, rotate it. Just for sake of it, I'm gonna rotate it with this one, just so you can kind of see what it looks like when you just grab it and move it around. 175, 180, boom. That looks good. And then go back to my other widget, because that's the one I like the best. Move that over. Now everything matches. Sweet. So we have a functional little table here. Nothing super complicated. Like, honestly, we didn't even... This is cubes. We didn't even touch anything other than that. We definitely could. We have a little bit of time. I can do whatever y'all want for the last little bit or answer questions. This is really, really basic stuff in terms of... Yes?
Texturizing and coloring it.
Okay. Super complicated. Not really. Basics, I can go over. Texturing is different. But basic colors... So remember the magic side panel over here where everything cool happens? This is where you're at. You've got this one right here. So modifiers, mesh data, and then the little circle that has the shading on it. That's actually where your colors are going to be. So you pop up here. Looks kind of weird. You hit new. And now you've got a new material on here. So let's just name this like table and without caps lock. If you're familiar with color stuff. So you've got your diffuse and your specular, which is your... layer. I'm not an artist necessarily. I don't use technical terms always the most right. I'm apologizing. But we can get kind of close. So that's your basic. If you wanted to make multiple materials on a single object, you know, you're not always going to have the same texture across all of your objects or color. What you can actually do, so let's say I'm actually going to have to add a second material to this. Hit new, you know, maybe we'll make it table surface, tabletop. And we'll take this and make it some lighter color. Then you can actually hit assign. So now we have two separate things happening right here. It can be a little weird because when you start out by default, whatever one is there, the whole thing is applied to it. So you have to make a second and then assign it to that. Yeah.
How would you do the assign of one thing, like for shading?
What do you mean by that?
Like, you have the thing that comes down. How would you do the side that we're looking at a different color than the side from this way, a different color?
So just for, like, the purpose of lighting purposes?
Yeah.
This is when Blender is magic. Blender is going to do that part for you, basically. So just for looks. So if you hit 0, you're going to go into your camera view. You can hit Shift-F to fly around, and we're going to go right there. If I hit F12, I'm going to render whatever's right there. So now... It's a light simulation device, and this is using Blender Renderer, which is right there. There's a Blender Cycles Renderer. You can get really cool stuff. I'm not an expert in that. Look that one up online. But that's where you get, that's actually ray casting. Blender Render is more akin to what you'll see in the game engine. And this looks kind of bad because there's nothing here on it. To make it look a little better, let's just add a plane, scale it kind of big so we can see something, you know, see a shadow. That'll give us... a little bit better feel, but that light is just awful. It's because this is a point light. This point light, we can actually change the light to different types. For this example, it's great to just do a sunlight. Sunlight gives universal, like everything has the same shadow casting down. So now we're starting to look much, much better. From here, there's actually a great setting that, give me a second to find it. I think it's, is it on the camera? No, it's on the world. Yeah, here we go. So just like you have, so modifiers, objects, actually textures would be this one. If you want to look into textures, you apply them to a specific material, and then there's a UV unwrapping tool right there where it says default. There's actually a drop down that allows you to do a UV texturing, and that's where you can add in all that stuff. You can unwrap your texture, unwrap your meshes, and then apply the textures that way through your materials. It all kind of has to trickle, so a lot that has to kind of go into place. But anyways, modifiers, materials, this is the world settings. And this magical one right here, this changed my life. It was great. Ambient occlusion, turn it on, and my magic number is 0.05. Don't ask why. It just looks great. And let's just take that. Let's see if I can do this right. So this was the previous render, and now if we render it, it looks much better. Changes. So if I can, I think we can. No, it won't let me do that. You can see the difference. There we go. Slot two, slot one. Ambient occlusion just allows the light to bounce around the scene, doesn't give you perfect hard shadows. And this is something that's a little different too, because if you're using Blender for art, okay, also, it looks way better on my computer screen than on that. Let me see if I can change it so it looks a little bit more akin to what I'm doing. Let's turn it up. Yeah, that's a little bit more like what it looks like on my screen. So you can see. Light looks a lot more realistic. It's got a lot of jitter, but that noise is because we're using not the best engine inside of here. This is the one that I grew up with 10 years ago. The new one came out like 3, and I haven't played around with it. But again, this is really only changing settings in Blender. If you take this into Unity, that work with the light is going to kind of be lost. Your materials and your texturing, that's going to travel with you, which is great. Any other questions? Do you have a question? You're stretching.
No, I'm stretching.
Okay. I was hoping you got engaged, man. Other last thing to touch on, because we really didn't touch on this, and this is a pretty big core tenet of 3D modeling in general. Pretty much all we've really touched on this whole time is moving objects around scenes, not actually changing objects so much. This is the whole reason I brought the whiteboard. So, is anyone familiar with extruding? Yes.
I have a question.
You can talk about what you're
about to say first.
Okay. Oh, you have another question?
No, I do have a question, but
Is anyone familiar with extruding? Okay, cool. So you know what I'm about to talk about. So the basic premise of extruding is taking a point and allowing more data off of it. So let's say you have a nice little ball of yarn. And you take that one strand of yarn out and you just go, and so it's just pulling that extra strand of yarn out. Think of it as a single vertice, and if you hit extrude, you're now creating, instead of a one-dimensional point, you actually now have a second, or instead of a point, you actually have dimension to it, it has a length, so you created a line. If you were to take a face and extrude this edge right here, you would actually create an entire another face, because this stays the same with this right here, and this is the new data that's created when you extrude. Similarly with 3D space. So to kind of give you a little bit more example of what that looks like, let's go into this. We're gonna make a simple little cup. Very, very simple, for the sake of time. So if we make a circle, circles doesn't even have a face on it, so you can hit F to make a face. Ooh, there's a face. If I was to extrude this data right here, hit E to extrude. Now you can see all of this magically has depth and power. So if we take this up, and I'm hitting a control to snap it to the Z-axis. Look, we now have a cylinder. So we took a simple object and added more dimension to it. So let's make this a little bit more complete. We're gonna scale it out. And it's not just adding stuff, you can also kind of like build into itself. So think of a solo cup. You know, you've got that little lip on it, and then it goes down. So we're going to extrude it, and then you can actually extrude it and leave it upon itself, and then scale it from there. It's a little weird trick, but if you follow many Blender tutorials, you'll see that. I'm going to extrude it up, so now you can kind of see it looks more like a little, like a flower pot. But we're going to take this, extrude it, right-click to leave it on top of where itself, so you can actually see there's data right on top of itself. So that way we have everything snapping on nice even planes, rigid 90-degree angles pretty much. Scale that, so now we have something of an inside that we can work with that. And we're gonna take this and extrude it down. Disregard the fact that our cup is now going inside of itself for a brief moment. And then we can take this and scale it back. So if we look at this in wireframe mode, we can kind of see a little bit of what happened. So we just made a nice simple little cup. From here, this is where you got ahead of me, but if we were to do multiple materials here, then we can do a white and a red. Take this red, apply it. So see, the material doesn't apply because you have to select something and then assign it. By default, everything is this first material. So we're gonna select that, and this right here. Assign that, and boom, we've got this very simple little cup. And if we come back to our scene over here, whoops, both of them. Yes, we have a cup worthy of mine. so you can take this right here and just scale it down.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, you know, everything's scaling. You can shift duplicate it. Oh, this is a shortcut that I've got on my paper, just for sake of time. I've got my paper, but it's really great. You can hit grab and an axis to move it in that axis. So, you know, I can hit grab an X and move it one way, and then hit Y and move it in the other way, you know, to get it somewhere else. Grab Y, move it over here. But maybe I wanted to do both at the same time. I can, let's do it. So I can hit grab and then shift Z. And you can kind of see, yeah, you can see it fairly well. You have both of these guidelines put up, so it's actually not gonna drop at all. So let's say you're building a room and you know you wanted to move this chair over here. Well, instead of moving it, you know, Charlie Brown style, go straight and then turn and then go straight, you can just hit shift Z and it negates Z movement. So it's not doing this crazy stuff, it just moves it in both the X and Y axis at the same time. It works for everything. Negate one axis and do the others. So it's really great for moving stuff around a table and not having stuff go flying in crazy directions. Yes, you have a question from earlier.
So what would you do about rounding out the edges?
Oh, like this table?
Yeah.
There's different ways to do it. I'm going to pray that this works really well, because if it does, it's going to be great. We're going to do it not on the cup, but on the table, because I know it won't work well on the cup, but there should be a subsurf modifier. Oh, no, it looks awful. So basically what this is doing is averaging all the points into a curve. But let's say I'm going to actually add a simple subsurf on it first. So now if I was to look at it in the mesh data, you can see it's subdivided. It's subdivided out, and so I can increase that. Now we have a lot more mesh data, and from there, if I was to add a second subsurf, whoops, come on. Now, that's, ooh, now my computer's freaking out because there's so much mesh data to try to render. But you can see, it's got a lot more curve. I didn't change anything, it's all modifiers. This is actually what I'm hoping to go over in our Blender stream on the 20th. Is much more modifier work, because this is where a lot of power sits. We didn't even talk about arrays, and those are great. Yes?
So one thing I've been confused about when I watched the modeling videos is the polygons. They say don't go over 4 points. Why?
Oh, okay. So basically, there's a lot of different reasons why. It's weird. Blender allows n-gons, which is a fancy word for any number of sided polygon, so 5 and up. With n-gons, you reduce Blender's ability to like calculate the face. So you might have, I don't know if I can save this in time. Let's do this over here. So if I was to make a plane right here and to grab this one point and move it up, if you look at this, like, so you see, in one orientation, this treats it as like a big piece of paper. But in another orientation, it looks like it's bent the other way. Do you see what I'm saying? See, it has that shape to it. But I didn't change anything. It's just the angle at which Blender's trying to compute what's actually going on here. That's what's happening with this quad. With n-gons, it's just way worse. There's also a lot of other problems. When you start using loop selects, which are great tools, allows you to, so like if I was to, yeah, exactly. Going on this cup right here, if I was to select this, instead of selecting one point at a time, going around this whole circle and like holding shift, you can do a loop select, boom, and select the whole line at the same time. We have an n-gon on there. N-gons don't like loop selects, so you might like go partially and then hit an n-gon, and then it'll just stop. It won't select the rest of the loop. So doing quads with that helps a lot in that regard. Also, the bigger thing for me, because I do a lot of this with most of my Blender skills, move towards Unity. So like building this asset to build in Unity. when you build with n-gons, Blender might render them consistently in one way. Unity, on the other hand, might interpret that n-gon data in totally different ways, because usually Unity's building it out as triangles, and Blender's trying to usually build it out as quads. So with that, it's gonna just interpret things inconsistently. So if you built it intentionally with the quads, it doesn't have as much of a choice, but it's gonna interpret it this way.
So you'd recommend quads over tries?
That's kind of a personal preference. I think Unity builds it into tries anyways. I'm used to quads, Blender likes quads, everybody likes quads. I think that's a personal preference, and maybe you have a specific scenario where that's the case where you need that. Quads were great. Any other questions? Cool. My handle's on there if you want to reach out. BlueHatZach is in the bottom corner. On any social media, if I'm on there, that's it. Yes?
So what's your next?
The next stream. Yeah, thank you so much for that. The next stream is July 20th, I believe. It's a Tuesday. No, 24th. That's it right there. July 24th on the GGDA stream. We will either be going over Blender and Unity stuff or Blender and Modifiers, which I'm more of a fan of because that kind of leads well out of this. Also, this other stuff similar to this has already been on the GGDA stream, so you can go back and watch those videos on demand. Yeah.
July 24th, is there an actual event, or is there...
No, this is, the GGDA has a Twitch stream, so like the other rooms, Twitch streaming. You can probably cut it here, we're just answering.
Okay.